good morning. We are very pleased to welcome you all to this third policy lecture in our Trade Dialogues series. Our speaker today is Professor Eric Verhoogen from Columbia University. He's an associate professor of international and public affairs and economics. His main research area is industrial development, and more specifically, applied microeconomic research on firms in developing countries. This area actually overlaps with the fields of development economics, international trade, labor economics, and industrial organization. A recurrent theme in his work is the process of quality upgrading in the manufacturing sectors of developing countries, its causes, consequences, and broader implications. He holds a PhD from the University of California, Berkeley. I wish to warmly thank Professor Verhoogen for having accepted our invitation to come and present the results of his research and of other related research on the effects of trade on wage inequality. As usual, Professor Verhoogen will speak for about 45 minutes, after which we will have a questions and answers session. The floor is yours.
Okay. Thanks very much. I think I'll stand up so that I can feel more, a little bit less a difference of level here with the audience. I'm going to walk down below. Okay, so thanks very much for coming. Thanks very much for the warm reception. I'd like to start my talk here just with this is reproducing a graphic from a recent report from the OECD, a report called In It Together, it came out last year. This is something that's not surprising to anyone in the room, that over the last three decades, inequality has increased in many countries in the OECD. You can see here, I guess it doesn't reproduce very well, but for most countries in the OECD, there's been an increase in inequality. There are a few countries, there's been basically neutral, and Turkey is the only country, at least at this point, that saw a decline. Now, most of these are richer countries. There's one country, which is going to be the main subject of my talk, is Mexico. You can see has high level of inequality and also an increase. But broadly, there's been a broad increase in inequality. This is measured by the Gini coefficient, but a similar pattern would show up if you used other measures. Now, for developed countries, and I understand that you had a talk by David Dorn last week. Okay, so for developed countries, there's been wide recognition that trade is likely playing some role. Okay, I'm going to try and give a very non-technical talk, but I want to try and explain the underlying theory that many economists, and in particular trade economists, have in their head when they're thinking about these issues of trade and wages. Okay, and that theory was named after two Swedish economists, Heckscher Ohlin, who were writing in the 1930s. It's sometimes referred to as the factor proportions theory. Okay, and I'm going to think about the simplest possible model, which has two countries, two goods, and two factors. So you think of this as unskilled and skilled labor. Okay, and the idea here is that when a country that is abundant in skill, that has many skilled workers relative to unskilled workers, call that the north, integrates with a country that has many unskilled workers relative to skilled workers, call that the south, the north is going to shift towards specializing or producing more of the skill-intensive good. Whatever, if there's two goods, one requires more skill than the other, and the north will specialize in the skill-intensive good. That process will tend to increase the demand for skilled labor relative to unskilled labor, okay? And that is going to increase inequality in the north. That's sort of the standard, simplest intuition, okay? And that's consistent with the idea that inequality would rise in the north. That's not particularly controversial among trade economists. The main debate has been over the magnitude of the effect, not whether there is effect, but how large it is and how much it's responsible for the rise in inequality in the northern countries. Okay, so since you had the talk by Hansen last week, I won't emphasize, but they've done some important work. I won't go into detail. They've done some important work on the effect of the entry of China into the world trading system on the U.S., showing important negative impacts. And also, there's a recent paper here, cited here on the U.S. He may have talked about it also, explaining political polarization in the U.S. And there's other papers. This is a paper on Germany showing that so essentially regions that are very negatively affected by Chinese trade, you see greater support for right-wing candidates. In Germany, there's similar research in France as well. Okay, so that's all developing countries. That's all developed countries. Now, the topic of my talk and much of my research is going to be developing countries. And there's been less agreement even on the direction of the effect. Is there a relationship between trade and inequality? And if so, which direction is the effect going? Now, I'd say until recently. More recently, I'd say there's a little bit more consensus. But at least for a long time, there hasn't been much consensus. Why? So let's go back to that Heckscher-Ohlin theory, back to the simplest model that I told you about. Okay, but think of it now from the perspective of the South. Right? So what's going to happen when the South integrates with the North? The South is unskilled labor abundant. It's going to specialize in more unskilled labor intensive activities. That's going to tend to increase the demand, or should, in principle, increase the demand for unskilled labor. And that should actually bid up the wages of unskilled workers relative to skilled workers. And inequality should decline in the simplest model. Okay? So that's the intuition that many economists have in their head. There is accumulating evidence that inequality in many developing countries has increased at the same time that trade has increased. Okay, I won't. The key reference here is a review paper by Penny Goldberg and Nina Pavchnik in 2007, where they went in a series of developing countries: Argentina, Brazil, Chile, Colombia, Hong Kong, India, Mexico, and showed that this pattern held. Okay, but it creates something of a puzzle, in the sense that the standard theory suggests that wage inequality should be declining. The data seems to suggest that at the same time trade is happening, inequality is going up. Okay, and it hasn't been clear the connection. You can do, if we depart from the simplest Heckscher-Ohlin model that I wrote down, so you can have more complicated Heckscher-Ohlin models for style models. For instance, Mexico integrates with the US and at the same time China enters, and Mexico is intermediate in its skill abundance relative to the US and China, then you can get effects where inequality goes up in Mexico in the standard types of theories. Okay, but those theories require, in order to see rising inequality, in order for, in the theoretical mechanism for trade to be explaining rising inequality, it must be the case that resources are shifting and production is shifting towards more skill-intensive activities, and typically people have not found evidence of that. Okay, so all of which is to say is it looks like the standard model doesn't explain very well rising inequality in the South. Okay, and so the dominant view was, at least when I started working in this area a number of years ago, I'd say the dominant view was the rising inequality in the South must be due to factors which are not related to trade. And the standard, other factor would be skilled bias, technical change. So technological changes that increase the demand for skill that led to rising inequality. Okay, so that was the argument in particular in this paper by Berman, Bound, and Matchin. Okay, so what am I going to do in this talk? What I'd like to do is give you a non-technical summary of a research program I've been engaged in for a number of years now. That will be, part of it will be old news for the PhD economists in the room, but I, for the benefit of the broader audience, I'm going to go ahead and review some of this work. It's a research program showing a link between trade and wage inequality in developing countries. Okay, through a particular mechanism, which I'm calling the quality upgrading mechanism. I'll talk in more detail about what I mean by that. As I said, I'm going to be focusing on Mexico, which is the outlier, the one poor country in that OECD graphic I showed. You might say, why focus so much on Mexico? Partly, I'm very attached to Mexico. I now have affection for the place. But also, I think it's illustrative, in part because Mexico had a very stark experience of liberalization. It was a quite closed economy until the mid-80s, and then quite quickly opened and became one of the more integrated economies. Okay, so I think it's a useful example for that reason. And then another reason, which also explains why I started working there, is it has quite good data that allows us to get at some of these questions. Okay, but I think many of the insights from the Mexican case generalize. Now, you might ask the question at the end, how much did they generalize? How do you know they generalize? And there's more work that has to be done in order to convince you. But I do think that this is the examples are not specific, or the statements I'll make are not specific to Mexico. Okay. I'll also briefly review some other mechanisms that have been proposed linking trade and inequality in developing countries, similar to the quality upgrading mechanism. I'll provide a bit more evidence on the quality channel, There's now a debate ongoing in the academic literature about which of these channels seem to be most important. And at the very end, I'll come back and say, do we have a brief discussion of the normative and political implications of this work. Okay, so please, I don't know what the culture is about jumping in and asking questions while I'm speaking. I'd be quite comfortable with having you jump in and ask questions if you'd like. Okay, so this is now, first this is to motivate. As you saw, so inequality rose in Mexico over in the first graphic, I said, from 1985 to 2013. That increase in inequality was concentrated between the mid-80s and the mid-1990s, following Mexico's entry into the GATT in 1985-86. Okay, so you can see this is a couple of different measures of inequality. There's the green line, the green triangles are just the log 90-10 ratio. That's just comparing the 90th percentile and the 10th percentile of the wage distribution from household data. Okay, so that increased quite sharply. And then the blue diamonds are this is now plant level data, manufacturing plant data, looking at the ratio of white collar wages to blue collar wages within manufacturing plants, taking an average. That increased quite sharply, reaching a peak sometime in the mid 90s. There's some depends a little bit on the data set how. Since then, this is coming from a paper, this is the data that was available when I was working on this paper. Since then, it's basically stabilized and declined slowly. Okay, so the main increase in inequality in Mexico was from mid-80s to mid-1990s, and since then a small decline. Okay, and so this is the paper, 2008 paper, which I'm drawing from. Now, okay, so what was particularly interesting about that is you saw that rise in inequality. At the same time, you saw shifts across sectors that were consistent with that simplest Heckscher-Ohlin model I was telling you about. Okay, so if you just plot, this is now, say this is the log capital labor ratio, each dot is a four-digit industry. Okay, look at the log capital labor ratio on the x-axis, and on the y-axis I have the change in log employment from 1988 to 1998. Okay, so this is a period of liberalization in Mexico. And what do you see? So basically, which are the industries that are growing the fastest in the sense of largest increase in employment? They're exactly the least capital-intensive industries. Okay, this is low. So low capital labor ratio have high growth. So this is especially, apparel manufacturing. It's low tech electronics. There's a little bit of auto parts. They're all going to be over here in this region. Okay, and the more capital intensive industries saw a relative decline. Okay, you could do that also. You could do a similar thing. It's a little bit noisier if you look instead at average schooling instead of the capital labor ratio instead of capital intensity. But you see a similar basic similar declining pattern. Okay, obviously with more noise here, but it looks like the sectors that have the lowest average schooling tend to be growing faster than the ones that don't. So that's consistent with the simplest Heckscher-Ohlin story, right? That the South should specialize in unskilled labor intensive activities. Okay, so that in the simplest model, that would suggest that we should see inequality declining in Mexico rather than rising, as we saw in the first graph. Okay, so there's something puzzling there. So what's the story? So I'm going to give you in a somewhat anecdotal form of telling this what the story is. And the story is what I could call differential quality upgrading. So first of all, what do I mean by quality upgrading, and then what do I mean by the differential part? Okay, so here's an example. So the Volkswagen Puebla plant. There's been a large plant by Volkswagen in Mexico since, I believe, it was 1964 it was founded. It was for many years the only producer of Volkswagens in North America. It was producing for the US market as well as for the world. This plant produced the new Beetle, okay? And it also produced, until 2003, and while I was working on this, it produced the old Beetle, okay? The old Beetle was, for many years, the modal car in Mexico. It was the something like 40% at some point of the market was actually was what they call the Volcho, they call it the old Beetle. All the taxis. This is just a picture I took one day walking around in Mexico City. All the taxis in Mexico City were the old Beetles. Okay. Now there are many quality differences between these two cars. Almost all of the new Beetles were sold in the U.S. or in rich countries. Very few were sold in Mexico. Almost all the old Beetles were sold in Mexico. okay? And there's various quality differences between them, reflected in differences in prices. So the old Beetle, the seats were made out of, they had coconut fibers in the seats. You had to crank up the windows by hand. The doors were sort of thin. They didn't make that nice solid sound when you closed them. The new Beetle was state of the art. It was polyurethane foam in the seats. It was everything electronic, et cetera, okay? All right. Now, the difference in product quality is paralleled by a difference in the types of workers who are working on the different production lines, okay, and the technology that's used on the different production lines. Okay, so an interesting thing about this plant was that you had the two lines juxtaposed. So you had a welding line for the old Beetle, which looked kind of like what my image of a factory was. There are people with masks and welding, and there are sparks flying, and it sort of looks like a traditional thing. And then there's you have it right just next to it, in the next building over, you would have the welding line for the Jettas and the new Beetles and the Gulfs, which are the high quality varieties that were being produced. So here are just a couple of pictures. These guys, so the guys making the old Beetles, they're referred to as técnicos. They typically have 9 years of education. Their starting wage at the time was about $11 a day. It's very, it's actually the same technology that was in place in Germany in the 1960s. It was just imported, and it stayed the same in this factory in Mexico. And it's quite, I call it artisanal. It's, a lot of things are done by hand. So it's there's skill in some way, but it's not very high tech. Okay, and then this—it's not a very high quality picture, but this is the welding line for the Jetta. Okay, and these orange arms you can see here are robots. No welds are done by a person on the Jetta in this factory, as this is also true in many in other car factories as well. Everything is done by robots. The only people who enter—they're either the skilled technicians who fix the robots when they break down, or there's someone in the background. There's an engineer who's programming the robots. Okay, and those guys, so the blue-collar guys who are fixing the robots are referred to as especialistas. They typically have 9 years of education plus 3 years they study on the plant grounds. There's 12,000 people who work in this factory. They have a school where they train people, and so the especialistas are graduates of that school. So they're quite a bit more skilled, and typically their wages reflect that. Okay, so now what happened? So they have quality differences, and they may be juxtaposed within plants. High quality versions being sold to rich destinations, lower quality to poor destinations. Okay. Now, as you may know, so this is back in the end of December 1994, there was a major devaluation of the Mexican peso. There's a financial crisis. Mexican peso lost about half of its nominal value in overnight, essentially, in the space of a couple of weeks. The real exchange rate rose, so it's typically that's reflecting a devaluation of the currency. And let's think about what happened in this factory. So first of all, let's look at purple line. So you can see that from 1994 to 1995, there was a big increase in the share of the output of this factory that was exported. Okay, why it happened? So two things happened. One, the domestic market shrank. Okay, and two, the export market increased, or the exports increased. So Mexican costs now were very competitive relative to other countries, and so they were able to expand exports. So that's what happened there. And then the other thing that happened, now the black line is the share of the output, what I'm calling export varieties. These are the high quality modern cars. Okay? So which was the new Beetle, the Jetta, and the Gulf. Okay? And so what's left out here of this list is the old Beetle. Okay? And so you saw that the production of the new Beetle, Jetta, and Gulf went from about 60% of the output up to 90%. Okay? So and the old Beetle went from about 40% of production down to about 10%. Okay? So you can see that effectively you got an increase in the average quality of car produced in this plant just because they're running the production line for the new varieties more heavily, and they're restricting production of the old Beetle, the old varieties. Okay? And then given the mix of laborers, essentially the mix of workers, that increase in average quality led to a skill upgrading as well. So they're using more of these especialista guys and fewer of the technicians. Okay? All right, so that's the story for Volkswagen. Here now is, this is now data from a balanced panel of manufacturing plants. Essentially 3,000 plants that we can follow over time, the same 3,000. This is just to show you that the similar pattern that you saw here in this purple line in the Volkswagen plant was reflected in the manufacturing sector as a whole in Mexico. So you can look at The green line is export share of sales, again, from 1994 to 1995. That increased both because of an expansion of exports and because of a decline in sales to the domestic market. You could also measure this as you want, as the blue diamonds, as the share of plants with any exports. Okay, so that went, this is now using, the blue line is using this right-hand axis. So the share of plants with any exports went from about 30% in this sample up to about 45%, okay, or share of year. So now we can't see in the manufacturing data, we can't see product level detail at the same level we can as you know, we have for the auto sector and for these plants that we can go and walk around. But the argument is that we expect that there to be a increase in average quality in these plants that are increasing exports as well. Okay, and I'll come back in a bit. We have a little bit of evidence of that. We can observe ISO 9000 certification. It's an international production standard which is generally interpreted to reflect product quality. Okay. Okay, so that's let me try and give you the theoretical story that's running around in the background here. Okay, I hope this is not too, I'm not becoming too much of an economist here. Okay, so I want to think theoretically, I want to think of this lambda as the underlying productivity or entrepreneurial ability of a firm. Okay, so these guys, high lambda just means they're more able, they're more with it, the entrepreneurs. Low lambda, they're less able, they're less with it. And then here I want to just think about the quality of goods that they're going to produce. This bottom dotted line, that would be the quality produced for the southern market, S for southern. The top dotted line would be the quality produced for the northern market. Okay, so now let's ignore the solid black line for a second. So think of Volkswagen as out here at the high end. Okay, it's going to be a very quite capable entrepreneurs, quite productive factory. Okay, and then but the idea is that Volkswagen out here is going to produce something like a low quality car or lower quality car for the southern market for Mexico, and a high quality car for the northern market, say for the U.S. Okay, so that's the old Beetle. There's the new Beetle up there. Okay, what the solid black line is, or the Q bar line is, here would be the average quality produced in the plant. Okay, so in fact, the Volkswagen is producing some old Beetles and some new Beetles. So on average, we'll say its quality is there. Okay, now, why are we having this jump here? So this is there's a new sort of generation of thinking, I'd say, in trade about heterogeneous firms, and the standard model in that new generation of thinking, or the sort of workhorse model, is developed by Mark Mellitz, has published in 2003, and the idea is there is that there's some fixed cost to entering the export market. Okay, as a result, you're going to have some guys who are low productivity are just not going to be able to. They're not going to have the expectation of earning enough on the export market to justify paying that fixed cost. Okay, so there's going to be some guys, some low productivity guys, who are just going to stay in the domestic market. They're not going to export at all. Okay, and then there's some critical level, some cutoff level above which firms will enter the export market as well as the domestic market. Okay, so for those guys who are in the export market, then their average quality is going to be sort of an average between the QN and the QS curves. Okay, for the low productivity guys, they're only going to be in the domestic market, so their quality is going to be given by this, just whatever they do, or whatever they're doing for Mexico for the southern market. Okay. Okay. Now, take that system, hit it with an exchange rate devaluation. Okay. What's going to happen? A couple of things. So one is, it turned out in Mexico, basically there were some exit at the low end. So low productivity guys just went out of the market. There's a big contraction of the domestic market. So in some sense, this is the cutoff for remaining in the domestic market. That shifted to the right. Also, this was the cutoff for exporting. That's going to shift to the left. Mexican now it's more attractive for Mexican firms to sell to enter the export market. Okay, their costs are lower. They're going to be able to sell more, say in the U.S. is Mexico's main export market, and so therefore some firms that were sort of just on the margin or just below the margin for exporting before may decide to enter the export market. Okay, so that suggests that's why this cutoff is shifting a little bit to the left. Okay, there's also an effect that the quality, at least in the model that was written down, the quality that they produce for the northern market, because their costs are lower, they'll actually decide to produce a slightly higher quality good. That's not crucial, but it's plausible. And so the solid black will shift to the solid gray line for a couple of reasons. So one is, as I said, the quality sold for the northern market may go up a little bit, but the main point is just I'm just selling more to the northern market than I am to the domestic market. That was the Volkswagen story, right? I just run my production line for the export market harder. I produce more, okay, and I produce less for the domestic market. So then that's going to lead to a shift here in the average quality for these high lambda guys. So like Volkswagens, we would shift from the black to the gray here. Okay? And then there's a set of guys who just entered, so they're going to have a large change. And then a set of guys who were in the domestic market before, they're still in the domestic market, there's not going to be much of a change there. So if you just take the difference between the gray line and the black line, it would look something like this. Okay? So you're going to have, for the high product firms, you'd see a large increase in quality, an average quality at the plant level. There's a set of firms these are the guys who entered, so there you see an especially large increase in quality. And there's a set of guys who they were in the domestic market before, they're in the domestic market after, you see essentially no change in quality. Okay? And so that's sort of the prediction that in this work, in this original paper and then some follow-up papers, which I'll talk about, we're trying to take the data. Okay? Which is it the case that in response to the pace of evaluation, is it the case that you saw initially more productive firms and who also tend to be larger, increasing quality more than initially less productive firms? And along with quality, you go a number of other observable dimensions, and in particular, wages. So the idea underlying here is that to produce high quality goods, you need high quality workers to whom you have to pay high wages. Okay, so the actual theoretical prediction would be you see an increase in wages that mimic the change in wages should mimic the change in quality. Okay, that's the theoretical prediction. Now let's go to data. So again, this is a balanced panel of about 3,000 plants that we can follow from the main data set I'm going to be talking about, can follow from 1993 to 2001. Since then, the data has been updated, but for now, I'm going to focus on those periods. And what are we doing here? So here, I'm just going to plot on the x-axis. It's always going to be log domestic sales, which is a measure of how large the plant is. Okay, the idea is that more productive firms are going to grow to be larger. So in some sense, the size is proxy. What economists would call proxying, and sort of a stand-in for how productive they are. And then here we have the export share of sales. Okay. So this first graph, and then for the black line here is showing just to do it in 1994. What's that saying? And the one other thing I should say is I'm always going to normalize. So we're going to put it zero. So everything's going to be deviated from a sector, what we'd call it, deviated from a sector year mean. So everything on average is going to have zeros for a given sector in a given year. So how do I interpret this then? Essentially what I'm saying is big firms within a given sector, okay, in 1994, they tend to have higher export share of sales than smaller firms in a given sector. Okay, that's all that's saying. So it's an increasing slope. And this is what we call a non-parametric fitted curve. It's just a sort of a curve fit to the data that doesn't impose, it doesn't have to be a line. We just could impose a curve to roughly summarize sort of the pattern in the data. Okay, so that was in 1994. Then what do you see in 1997? You see that curve, if you want to call it that, became steeper. Okay, so we see this is saying that initially larger firms in the domestic sales sense saw a bigger increase in the export share of sales than initially smaller firms. Okay, between 1994 and 1997. Is that clear? I'm going to show a few graphs like this, so I want to make sure that it's clear. Okay, so this is saying, so if you look at the gap between these two, you say, aha, okay, so from 1994 to 1997, these guys out here, the high productivity firms, they saw a pretty large increase in export share of sales relative to these guys down here who saw a decrease in export share of sales. Okay, that's consistent with this picture that I showed. It's the guys who are already exporting who are going to be able to take advantage of the fact that they're now more competitive in their costs and are going to be able to sell more on the U.S. market. These guys who are down below, they were. You know, not they didn't pay the fixed cost of entry into the export market before. They're not going to pay the fixed cost of entry into the export market later, and so they're just not going to have a big increase in exports. Okay, so you can do, so that one looks, this non-parametric graph looks a little jumpy. When you're looking at wages, the data sort of are less noisy, and you get a smoother pattern. Okay, but here I'm going to show a similar kind of graph. So I'm just plotting log domestic sales against, now here, the white collar wage. This is the wage of non-production workers, okay, in 1993 and in 1997. And we see a similar pattern arising. Again, and I've sort of taken out a mean, taken out an average in each sector in each year. Okay, but what we're finding here is that these initially larger plants, okay, which you can think of as the more productive plants, they saw an increase in the white collar wage, an increase in the wage of white collar workers relative to the initially smaller plants. Okay, we saw a relative decrease. Okay. You can do a similar thing for blue-collar wage. You say there's a little increase. Again, so you'll have to take my word for it. I'm not going to go through all the tables today, but these differences end up being statistically significant. You see that initially larger plants increase wages relative to initially smaller plants. Okay, for blue-collar workers. Now, another fact, if you can see this here, is that the increase in the slope for white-collar workers was greater than the increase in the slope for blue-collar workers. Okay, so in fact, not only did these guys who are initially large, who then increased, so what's the story? Initially large guys, they increased exports more than the initially small guys. Okay, they increased wages for both blue-collar and white-collar workers, and they increased the wage ratio between white and blue-collar workers. So they increased wages especially for the white-collar guys. Okay, now, to summarize, I'm trying to summarize here with my graphics. Now take this, I'm going to calculate the difference between the gray and the black. Okay, between 97 and 94, now for exports, and I'm going to call that, that's this now becomes this black line. That's the change from 94 to 97. Okay, and I'm going to compare it to a period when there wasn't a devaluation. Okay, so one concern you might have about this as well, is there some differential trends between larger and smaller firms that are in every period? That's all you're capturing. And so to argue against that, I'm going to say, well, I'm going to compare it to another period which didn't have a devaluation. Which would be the period from 1997 to 2001. That's the one that's covered in my data set. And there's not very much. There wasn't a devaluation then, and there was a slow appreciation of the currency. Okay. So then the black was the change between. So that's the difference between gray and black in my previous graph. And then I calculated a similar change for the later period. Okay. And so what's the point here? The point here is I see the initial period, the 94-97, I do see this differential change, so that the larger plants see a larger increase in export share than smaller plants. That's what the black line's telling me. And then also, there's not much of a difference in the later period. Okay, that gray line is pretty flat. Okay. You can do the same thing for white-collar wages. Again, that's the difference between 93 and 97. Larger plants increase more than smaller plants, and the change is pretty flat in the later period, and do the same thing for blue collar workers. Okay, so what's the story there? So the story there is, if you're willing, and I understand that there's lots of details here. I'm jumping over, but if you're willing to attribute a differential change in export status, okay, to the effect of the exchange rate devaluation, which had a differential effect by productivity or by firm size, okay, then you'd say, okay, I got a differential effect on exports, that generated a differential effect on white-collar wages and on blue-collar wages, okay, and this white-collar wage effect was larger than the blue-collar wage effect, okay, so the argument there is, I'm trying to attribute cause, I have a shock which had a differential effect on exporting, and that drove a differential effect on wages. Let's come back to that. Maybe you can ask me some questions. I don't want to go through this table. I'm already there's a lot of detail here. I'd just like to say you can show a similar pattern for ISO 9000, which is this international production standard that shifted in a similar way. So this is saying if you regress the change in whether a firm has ISO 9000 certification on the level of domestic sales. So this is sort of a regression version of those figures I was showing. Okay, you find. There's a positive slope both in the early period and the later period, but the difference between those, which is a little bit like the different graphs I showed, is positive and significant. So that's just to say that those initially larger plants were more likely to acquire ISO 9000 certification in response to this shock. Okay. I also was hopeful about a bunch of other different variables on whether training and turnover and accident rates and absentee rates, and there wasn't much there. Okay, so the product quality effect seems to be the main one. Okay. So now let me go on. That was the basic story. At the level of, now everything I'd show you so far was that using plant level data, plant panel, okay? So let me go on and try and unpack a little bit more of the wage outcomes here. Using data from the Mexican Social Security Agency tracks workers, so you can follow individual workers over time as they move from firm to firm, okay? So that's quite detailed data, and then we were able to link that to the manufacturing panel that I was talking about previously, okay? And we have a couple of papers following up using those data, that combination of data sets. Okay, so the first one, using pictures, which are, these are now, instead of, they're corresponding to the gray and black pictures I showed, the gray and black lines I showed you before. Okay. Where now what we've done though is to say, okay, let's look at instead of using mean wages or mean wages for white collar and blue collar workers, which is what I was showing before, what I can do in these employer employee data is I see individual wages for every individual in every plant. Okay? And so I can say, I'm going to look at different percentiles, what economists call quantiles. So I can look at, let's look at people at the 10th percentile of the distribution, 25th percentile, this is at the 50th percentile at the median, the 75th percentile or the 90th percentile. Okay, so I can look all through the distribution and I can look and say, okay, this differential effect I was talking about, this, you know, the shock had a differential effect on larger firms than small firms, where in the wage distribution did that have an impact? Okay? So if you look at the 10th percentile, that's saying, okay, well, it is the case that, and these are the changes here. So. Initially, larger plants. These are both upward sloping. So initially, larger plants in 97 in both periods had a larger increase at the 10th percentile than initially smaller plants. That might be some sort of background trend between larger and smaller plants. But there's no difference here between the earlier period and the later period. Okay. So we'd say here, if we believe my story, then you'd say, well, here it looks like there wasn't much of an effect of the exporting shock or the exchange rate shock at the 10th percentile of the distribution. Okay, but as you go to the 25th, and then the 50th, and the 75th, and the 90th, then you see more of a change in these slopes. Okay, so I'm seeing more. So essentially, what I'd say is there's more of an effect, more of a differential effect. These guys who increase exports increase wages. Okay, at these higher percentiles more than the smaller plants, and more than would be compared to a later period. Okay, you see. So and you can see that it's actually increasing. These slopes are becoming increasingly different. Up, well, certainly between the 25th and the 75th percentile, okay? The 75th and the 90th, those slopes, that difference in slopes is about the same. Here's another way, there's a regression table to communicate basically the same idea. What are we doing here? So we're regressing, I want to focus on these last five columns, we're regressing the change in wages at different quantiles, at different percentiles, okay? And relate that to the change in the export share, where now I've done something what economists call an instrumental variable strategy to try and isolate sort of the causal effect of the change in the export share on those wage changes. And what you see here is at the 10th percentile, if anything is negative and it's not statistically significant, and then the effect of the change in export share on wages at these different percentiles is increasing as you go through this distribution, okay? Except that in the 75th and 90th are about the same. Okay, so what's that saying? So it's essentially saying that this export shock is leading to an increase in wage dispersion within plants. Okay? So wages are going up overall on average, so that's something we showed before. In response to exports, so there's an export shock, wages go up overall, and they go up especially for the people who are at the higher end of the wage distribution. Okay? So especially for the white-collar workers. They were talking especially the engineers and skilled technical workers. Okay, so that was the first paper here. That was my nutshell summary. Let me try and give you a summary of the second paper, exports and wage premia. Yes.
Do we know what happened to the employment of skilled and unskilled workers?
Yeah, yeah. So good question. And so there I have to refer you to the paper. But basically, the employment shares almost didn't change. That was which surprisingly to me. So all the action was on wages, not on not on number of bodies, not on employment shares. Which is, I'm not sure how general that is. That's what we found. And that's, I'm thinking about the ratio of white collar to blue collar workers, which is this production, non-production worker distinction.
I'm thinking of the distribution we've got. Maybe the shares of CNC stay the same, but they are substituting towards technological improvements.
So you do see, good question. Okay, so right there I was just talking about the employment shares. You do see an investment response. So these guys who are, you know, they're exporting more and they're paying higher wages are also, they're also becoming more, they're also investing in capital more than the other guys. And so because there's not much of an employment response, they're becoming more capital intensive. Yeah, good question. Okay. So let me go now to this, so this is my only equation. I wasn't sure of the rules here in this presentation, whether I could have an equation or not. Let me try to explain the intuition at least. Okay, what I'd like to do now is to say, all right, there's a wage effect of exporting on average at the plant level, now, but that could reflect a couple of different things. That could reflect a change in the skill composition. That plant could just be going out and hiring people who would get a high wage no matter where they were on the labor market. Or it could be an effect on what we call wage premia, or what I might call it, what I also refer to as a plant component, okay? Which is to say, this firm may just pay more to workers than they would get elsewhere, okay? And so we'd like to know which of those two is true. Average wages go up because they replaced a bunch of their low-skilled workers with a bunch of higher-skilled workers, or is it that they just took the same set of workers and paid them more than they were before, relatively? Okay, so the way to get at that, or a standard way to get at that economics is to take a regression of the type established, it was sort of first done by Abel Cramars-Margolis in French data in a paper in Econometrica in 1999, where you just take log wage for individual I at time t, okay, and you would regress it on, this is what I'd call a year effect, an individual fixed effect, that's just a dummy for each individual, that's going to capture everything time invariant about that person. Those are some observable variables, might be age, tenure, et cetera, okay? And then this was in my case, a firm year effect. Psi j, you think of as the firm, that individual I is at time t, and then you have an effect that captures the jt effect. So if Volkswagen in year 1993, if there's some common component that explains everybody has high wages in Volkswagen 1993, that's gonna be captured by this term. I realize that's a little more technical than maybe you wanted, but anyway, that's what we do. So we can go through, we can estimate this model, okay, using the employer-employee data from Mexico. We can recover these plant year effects, okay. We can recover an average. I can estimate the alpha i's and these gammas, and I can recover this part. I think of as the individual specific component. I can average that, and I can get an average skill composition measure by doing that. Okay, and so then I realize I'm going quickly here, but essentially what these pictures would show would be, all right, I've got my average log daily wage, that's a positive slope, that's like what I showed you before. This is just saying guys with high domestic sales, large plants, they pay more than smaller plants. That much we knew. This is now in levels, and what I'm calling the plant component, that's that psi jt thing, that's the firm year effect. Okay, and then there's the person component. That's an average of the alphas and the x's and the gammas. Okay, so in principle, the person component plus the plant component should give you the total wage. Okay, total wage. And so what do we see? As I guess we'd expect. So that slope between firm size and wage is explained in part by the fact that these larger firms have a higher plant component, and in part by the fact that they're hiring higher skilled workers. Okay, so the person component is increasing in size, and the plant component is increasing in size. Okay, and so the slope of this plus the slope of this equals the slope of that. Okay, so that's just it's a way of decomposing the overall average wage effect into a part that's due to skill composition, a part that's due to wage premium. Okay, excuse me. Now, if you here, these are graphs like I was showing before. Okay, where I have a change. From 93 and 97, and a change from 97 to 2001 is the dashed line. And this is essentially the effect I showed before also, which is that the larger plants had a greater change relative to smaller plants in the 93 and 97 period than in the 97 to 2001 period. OK? Okay, so that's all just in the new data, but it's an effect that we saw before. Now, if I look for differences in the slopes of those curves between the plant component and the person component, I find that all the difference is driven by differences in the plant component, not by differences in the person component. Okay, so just what the way to interpret that is, this differential wage effect I saw between larger and smaller firms in response to the crisis are driven by changes in wage premia, okay, not by changes in skill composition. It's not that they're going out in wholesale, you know, shuffling around and getting a new set of workers. It's just that they're taking the same workers and paying them more. Now, there are many reasons why they may be doing that. My favorite story is that you're having to sell higher quality goods on the U.S. market. You need motivated workers, and so to motivate them more, they pay them a higher wage. Okay, that's one story, but I have to admit that there are other stories also that would explain that pattern. So this is a table similar to a table I showed before. Again, it's just a regression version of those graphs. I can take each of these. I can take the total average daily wage. I can take the plant component and the person component, and changes in those, and regress them on size in the initial year of the period. Okay, so there I get positive slopes, and when I do that. So what does that say? That's just saying, initially larger plants have a greater increase in wages, a greater increase in the plant component, and a greater increase in the person component than smaller firms in this 93-97 period. And you can do something similar in the later period, 97-2001, and you get not much differential change. So those are basically zeros. Okay. And so this difference between this coefficient and this coefficient is the thing that I'm trying to attribute to the effect of the devaluation and to a trade effect. And you see that. So you see effects both on the plant component and on the person component, but the effect on the plant component is just much larger. Okay, so it looks like most of the average wage change is driven by these wage premium. Let me give a time check, Mark. How much time do I have?
Five, ten
minutes. Okay. I have a lot of. This is the danger of putting these little circles up here on your slides, as people can see how many slides you have to go through. So we're getting there. I do want to tell you a bit about other. So I don't. It'd be unfair to say this is the only mechanism linking trade and inequality. Okay. So there's one mechanism linking trade and inequality. there are some others. And I'm going to talk about essentially two. Okay. One is what's referred to as the Fincher-Hansen outsourcing hypothesis. So you can think of, within a given sector, you can think there's many different activities which have different skill intensities. Okay, they have different amount of skill. Okay, and so what happens now? Typically, you'd expect the most skill-intensive activities to happen in the north. So think of north and south. In the north, where there are more skilled workers, and the least skill-intensive activities to happen in the south. Okay, and then what happens when there's trade liberalization of some sort? You might expect a shift. So certain things that we use, the least skill intensive activities produced in the north will shift to the south. Okay, but then if that's true, those are going to be the most skill intensive activities in the south once they arrive. Is that clear? And so that's what that could on average actually increase the average skill intensity in both places. Okay, because you take the least skill intensive activity in the north, shifted to the south, but that's going to be high skill intensity relative to what's happening in the south. Okay, so that mechanism could explain why average skill intensity goes up, why the return to skill goes up, so then there's more demand for skilled relative demand for skilled workers in both places, and why inequality might go in both places. So if you had to ask me, is this explaining what's happening in Mexico? Well, so I don't want to. There could be evidence for that. But it turns out in Mexico, actually, the maquiladora sector, the sector where you do most of the outsourcing happens, is actually quite unskilled labor intensive and low wage relative to the non-maquiladora sector in Mexico. Okay, so I think it's not the story in Mexico, but it is a very plausible story. So one other story, which I'll emphasize, would be a paper by Paula Bustos on technology upgrading. So I've talked about quality upgrading, but it could be just a technological, which has to do with consumer demand. What kind of products are consumers demanding? But there could be also a technological story, right? Which is, let's say that firms have a choice between a traditional technology, which has low fixed costs and high variable costs, and a new technology, which has high fixed costs. You have to pay a lot up front to invest in it, but it has low variable costs. Okay? Now, If that's the case, then the firms are having to decide choose between these two technologies. The scale of production is going to matter, right? The more I'm producing, the more I'm going to be able to take advantage of this new technology. The more I'm going to be able to spread those fixed costs over more units, my average fixed cost per unit is going to be lower, and so it's more likely that I'm going to want to adopt that new technology. The larger the scale is, okay? And so what does in this story, what does trade liberalization do? Well, for those initially more productive firms that ended up increasing exports, they're going to be producing at a larger scale, okay? And that might induce them in itself to pay the fixed costs and adopt this new technology. Okay. Anyway, Bustos has a picture which is similar to this picture that I tried to explain before. And she has a follow-up paper, and again, I'm not showing you the results here, but follow-up paper saying that when that happened, when firms, so she's using Argentinian data, sorry, here I do have this table. So this is now just relating changes in the spending on technology or different types of innovation, which you can think of as technological upgrading, to, in her case, it's Argentinian firms responding to tariffs in Brazil, okay? And so when tariffs in Brazil go down, okay, that should induce Argentinian firms to export more, and that should induce them to upgrade, okay? And she's finding, so you'd expect these regression coefficients, you'd expect a negative sign, that's what she's finding. And she finds that she finds consistently negative and significant signs, especially in the third size quartile. Okay, so she takes very seriously a graph like this and says, okay, we should find a larger effect for these guys who enter the export market. Okay, those are mostly going to be the third size quartile, and there she does find a differential effect of Brazil lowering its tariffs on the investments in technology of Argentinian firms, especially in that quartile. Okay. And she has a follow-up paper. Has a follow-up paper that looks at skill choices and shows that skill choices map into or follow the changes in spending on technology. Okay, I'm going to skip the Hellman-Skokie Redding. I'll skip that. I'll talk about one more paper. So there's probably more controversy in this literature than I may be communicating about whether the quality upgrading story or the patterns that I've showed you can be interpreted as quality. I think there's an accumulation of evidence to show that the quality upgrading is what's happening. So this section is about sort of additional evidence to support this story. Let me show you at least this picture. You saw this picture, I'll tell you what it is. So some co-authors, David Atkin, Amit Khandelwal, and Adam Osman, so I was not on this paper, what they did, but I encourage you to go look at it and read it. They convinced a buyer of rugs to randomly allocate initial export contacts to Egyptian rug producers. So these guys producing these sort of rugs in Egypt. Okay, and I don't know how they convinced the buyer to do that, but they did, and so they randomly allocated, and they ran an experiment about what's the effect of exporting on various dimensions. Okay, and the main thing they found, or at least my reading of the main thing that they found, was that these guys upgraded the quality of the goods, the rugs that they were producing. Okay, so they had a master artisan go through and evaluate the quality of all the rugs that are produced. These are all dimensions of quality of Egyptian rugs. And they found this is the intent to treat or effective treatment on the treat is essentially experimental effects. So the effect of being allocated initial export contact, all these guys, they end up producing different kinds of rugs, which are higher on all these quality dimensions. Okay, so that was one sort of evidence, an additional piece of evidence to support the quality story. Another piece of evidence, which I'll just summarize, and then we'll get to the conclusion, is Irene Brambilla, Daniel Lederman, and Guido Porto, in another paper, again using Argentinian data, found that when Brazil devalued, there was less demand for Argentinian products, okay, and that led some firms to increase the share of their exports that were going to rich countries, to the U.S. and Europe, and some firms, their exports increased to other countries about the income level of Argentina, so other places in Latin America, essentially. Okay, and when so they're looking at what happened to wages. Okay, and there they found, the nice thing about that paper is that they could separate the effect of exporting to a rich destination from just exporting per se, someplace else. Okay, and they found that it's really the exporting to rich destinations that tended to, that seemed to matter for wages rather than just exporting per se. Okay, and I have a recent paper which I was going to tell you about, which I'm not going to skip, sort of reinforcing that idea using Portuguese data where you can see actual input prices rather than the wages, you can actually see for material input prices that move in the same direction. Okay, I'll come back to that in the question section if you'd like to ask. Okay, so to summarize and then to a little bit the normative implications. So I've tried to argue that there is a causal link between trade and wage inequality in Mexico and by implication other developing countries. It leads to, so trade is going to lead to increased wage dispersion across plants. That's explained in large part by firms paying higher wage premia, not by changes in skill composition. And also you get increased dispersion within plants. You get increased inequality within plants. It's not the only possible mechanism, but it appears to be an important one. Now, one question I haven't answered, which I'm not going to be able to answer, so I want to get that out now, is that you say how much of the rise in inequality, say in Mexico or in other developing countries, is due to trade? And that's a hard question to answer convincingly, and it's something that, but it's something that I hope to work on in the future. So essentially, the argument so far is this mechanism appears to exist. There appears to be a link, but I don't know how important it is relative to migration or other possible technology or other possible factors. Okay, so now I guess about to things that I think are relevant to policy discussions probably here is, you know, we tend to think, is what I'm saying, is this a reason not to be less supportive of free trade? So we do tend to think of inequality as a bad. You know, it would seem to be a black mark against trade that it's increasing inequality in developing countries. On the other hand, it's complicated because, you know, in the story I'm telling, why is inequality rising within developing countries? It's partly because there's a subset of firms, which are not all firms, a subset of firms is able to be successful in export markets and produce higher quality goods and upgrade and do the things that, you know, are going to make them successful in international markets. Okay, so that's clearly a key part of the development process, right? We need firms to be doing that. And so some increase in dispersion among firms seems inevitable. It's not all firms are going to be able to export. And exporting, many people think, and I believe too, that exporting is important for growth. Okay. But I think the sort of moral of the story is that there's a role for policy to mitigate the effects. So to some extent, the rise in inequalities is inevitable. But there's a couple of things I think can and should be done. So one would be to promote upgrading of not only of the large firms that are able to, you know, to access export markets and be successful in export markets on their own, but also smaller and medium-sized firms, which generally might not be able to, okay, which are going to need more assistance in being able to access these export markets. Okay, so I think that in itself may tend to reduce inequality that's generated, right? Again, because smaller, medium-sized firms, they tend to be lower wage, they tend to be, the working conditions aren't as good, they're producing lower quality things, right? And if we can help those firms enter the export market, wages are likely to go up, they're likely to upgrade on various dimensions, and that's likely to have, you know, various positive effects on the economy. And then the other thing I'd say is, you know, we talk a lot in rich countries about the fact we need some sort of insurance. We need to insure people who are in risk, who have lost their jobs or at risk of losing their jobs due to trade. Okay, so that's clearly a part of the discussion now. But I think that needs to be also a part of the discussion in less developed countries, in developing countries as well. I think there is a link there. Many people in developing countries are skeptical of trade, partly, and they may not articulate it in this way, but partly because they have the sense that there is this relationship between trade and inequality. And so there needs to be a way to ensure and to some safety net, essentially, for workers who are displaced or who, you know, who do not share in the gains from increased trade. Otherwise, I think, you know, the erosion of support for trade that we've seen in the North, I'm, you know, still in shock from the U.S. election, or that you're also seeing in Europe, I think that's likely to also be true in lots of developing countries as well. People are going to perceive a link between these two, and they're going to, they're going to have a distaste for inequality, especially if they're on the low end, and that's going to tend to erode the support for trade in many countries, not just in the rich North. Okay, so that's what I have. I'm happy to open it for questions now.
Thank you very much, Professor Verhoogen, for the very interesting presentation. I will now just open the floor to any questions you might have. So I'll take three, and then let Professor Verhoogen respond to the three at one time. Marcelo?
Okay. So the going back to Mexico and the devaluation, you're attributing a lot of the effect to on wages and wage inequality and premium to exports. But the devaluation had many other effects. So imports also were restricted. So wouldn't part of the story, how do we know that part of the story of the increase in inequality is not due to the reduction in imports? Or perhaps the increase, I don't know exactly the story of Mexico, but when many countries devaluate, you have, and that's what was my earlier question earlier, when many countries devaluate, you have an important increase in foreign direct investment. So investment, foreign investment in the country that comes to get the cheaper stuff that are there, and where that investment had something to do with the what we saw on wages.
Other questions? Sorry, I can't see. Yep, sorry.
This was rather just a point of order. Could you ask people to use the microphone? There are interpreters who are providing interpretation into French and Spanish, and the question cannot be interpreted if you don't use a mic. Sorry.
Yeah, thanks for reminding us of this. Any other question? Yeah?
Two in the back.
So I'll take one here and then Raimundo.
Yeah, I was wondering, it seems that your mechanism really works about or through the the scale effects. So, you're arguing that if you export more, you have larger scale effects. But I think if you have a large domestic market, like the Chinese, for example, have, I wonder if your story would work also on that basis.
Okay, Raimundo.
Thank you very much for the presentation. And I guess for the sake of transparency, I am originally Mexican, so and I was in Mexico during some of the period you described there, working for a transnational company as an engineer. So what you said rings true to my own experience during that period. Now, one question is: you have focused on the pressure, the incentive, I guess, to compete in export markets, in the case of Mexico, in North America. Now, at the same time, and the period that you are looking at, Mexico, you pointed out, joined GATT, and I think that was back in 86. Before that, there was no import competition. The market was really closed through the use of import licenses. For example, in the motor vehicle industry, there were no imports of motor vehicles. End of story. After that, as part of the GATT membership, the market had to be open, at least gradually, through the use of tariffs in particular. And to what extent the effect that you see there is the effect of companies not only seeking perhaps to export, but to defend their market against import competition.
Thank you. I have a fourth one, so I'll take a fourth and then give you the floor. Is that okay?
Okay, that sounds right, yeah.
Juan.
Thank you, and thank you very much for the presentation. My question is related to what Marcelo was asking at the very beginning. Because in all the graphs that you showed, you are taking very short periods of time. So what you are actually explaining is that first there was a huge monetary shock, which is the devaluation, but then between 93 and 97, let's suppose after the devaluation, 94, 97, you are attributing the effect to a quality upgrade which has actually taken place or must have taken place in a very short period of time. And then that's probably explained why we have a sort of more a flatter pattern when we take another period of time after the devaluation, which probably speaks about a sort of more gradual quality upgrade. So my question is, how is it possible that that quality upgrade happens in such a short period of time? Wouldn't this be just, you know, the effect of the devaluation and then people increasing salaries of white collar workers just to keep them in the factory, fearing that, as Marcelo said, there might be competing investment coming and therefore competing for those workers as well? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Thanks very much. You can hear me, so yeah. So very good questions. Thanks a lot for those questions. Yeah, a couple are related to the fact that I'm trying to use a devaluation to learn something that I think would also be the case in a bilateral trade liberalization, right? And you're pointing out that those are not exactly the same things, right? I'd like to make the argument that this differential quality effect would also happen if we had a bilateral trade liberalization, that there would be, you know, some firms, larger firms, would be able to export, other firms would just have to face greater import competition, okay? And you'd find a similar pattern. Now, it's a devaluation, not a bilateral trade liberalization. That creates some differences. One, as Marcelo pointed out, is that, you know, imports became much more expensive after the devaluation. So my answer to that is that whether you imported your inputs was very highly correlated with whether you were an exporter or not. So it's those large firms are also the ones that suffered because of the higher price imports. So if anything, if that weren't the case, we would have even more of a differential effect. That these large guys, you can think of as these large guys doing well and paying higher wages was kind of a net effect of the increase in exports and the fact that their imported inputs were more expensive. But it's a fair point that it's true that devaluation will typically have those effects. I didn't want to say anything that I think FDI matters, so I didn't want to say anything about FDI not mattering. We don't have great information in Mexico about changes in FDI, and so therefore it's hard to evaluate that. Scale effects. Yeah. So I do want to say something about. Maybe I'll go back to this. Go back to this graph. So there is a debate between, I guess I'd say in the literature, between sort of a Bustos type of a story, which is about scale effects, or another one that I skipped over, Helpman and Skokie Redding, is about scale effects, versus what I would call an income-based quality channel, right? So why is it that, you know, firms in the South, firms in developing countries that end up exporting and selling to rich countries, they upgrade on various dimensions? Why is that? Is it just because their scale has increased, right? Or is it because they're doing something different to appeal to a different set of consumers, the richer consumers in their countries? In particular, they're producing higher quality goods because, you know, the richer consumers are more willing to pay for quality. And so I've been pushing the latter story rather than the former story. So I don't think scale effects are the whole story. I think it's this income-based quality channel. And so this paper that I skipped over, or this new one, with Paulo Bastos and Joana Silva, is making that case. And so one thing that we can do, similar to the Brambilla et al. Paper, what we can do there is we can relate the input prices, this is now in Portuguese, that the Portuguese firms pay for the material inputs, to the average destination of the average income of their destinations, okay? And we have, it's going to be too much to explain, but I have what I'd call an instrument. So I have a source of exogenous, a source of variation in the where they're selling, which is essentially exchange rates. So think about exchange rates move around where you sell. So Portuguese firms start selling more to Sweden and less to Brazil. Okay, it starts paying more for its material inputs. And that's the destination income matters. Just how much they ship, how much they're shipping total, doesn't seem to matter. Okay, so that's suggesting to me, at least, that it really is the income level of the destination that matters more than just how much you're selling. Okay, so that's an argument against the scale effect story and for this other story. Okay, we'll have to. That's all, unfortunately, I can say given the time constraints. So the question from I guess Raimundo in the back. So it's absolutely right. So I think that if in a standard trade liberalization story, you'd have both the increased exports and the increased import competition going on. Okay, and if you go back to my original graph, those graphs could apply in such a situation, where you'd have. I'll go back to. Go back to this one. These guys at the bottom, right, not only are they not able to access export markets, but they're also competing more against imports. So they're going to suffer relative to these guys, okay, who are also competing against imports, but they're able to sell more in the export market. Okay, so the it's absolutely true that both effects are going on, and ideally this kind of story would apply in a standard trade liberalization case. Okay, a good question about the short period of time. You know, how is it possible that the things are reacting so quickly? So there, the story I've had in my mind is sort of the Volkswagen story, where they're already producing the Jettas in the Gulfs. Okay, the new Beetle actually came a little bit later. I blurred over that thing. But they're already producing in the Gulf, and so they've already got the production line for the high quality, they've already got the production line for the low quality, and they're just running the high quality production line more. Okay, and so then on average it looks like there's a quick increase in the quality change, but it's just a shift in the composition of the products. Okay, now these guys, the Egyptian rug paper, they actually criticize that idea. So the idea is that that I've had is that the firms already know how to produce high quality, low quality, okay, and it's just a question of how quickly they shift between the high quality and low quality products. What these guys, one big point they make is not only that quality goes up, but it looks like that firms have to learn how to produce a different kind of good. It takes them some time, okay, and that they don't already know how to produce the high quality rugs, okay. And so that's the case. Then it's going to be a slightly slower process. Okay, and it's probably not going to respond. Probably not going to respond as quickly. Now, you know, is it going to respond? I don't know how long it takes. You know, if these guys have to produce high quality rug, within a couple of years they were able to do it. You know, when you look at what can I say? If I go back to my graph here, so if you look at this blue line, that was guys who share of plants exporting. So they're about 15% of plants. This one from about 30%. To about 45% exporting over the crisis, but you can see that wasn't immediate. So the export sales responded pretty quickly. That might be the Volkswagens responding, just running the production line. This is a question of a story about entry into the export market, right? It goes from about 30 to about 45%, so about 15% of firms, and it didn't happen right away. It took them a little bit more time. It was still going until 1997, okay? So that's true, it's a slower process. On the other hand, by 1997, then it seemed to have reached the peak, okay? So maybe within these 3 or 4 year periods, it would be okay. Is that to say there's no longer term learning? No, there clearly is longer term learning, but I think you know, a 3 or 4 year period is not, it's a reasonable length of time for firms to respond and start doing things different. Okay. I'm happy to.
Maybe I could take one or two more, but that, are there more questions?
I see a couple of hands, yeah.
Okay. So, please.
Thank you for the excellent presentation, and thank you for the convening this lecture session. I wanted to raise this question that how much we can look at the internal market than the outside market, your example, and then should we totally, you know, forget the internal market, you know, because the share that you presented here, you know, just shows that, you know, it is just outlooking, you know, for the export, and also the implication of the technology. That might be fly to the previous lecture, but I ask, you know, this here, that regarding the technological and the high quality products that increased, you know, the export through the liberalization, how does it affect, you know, the employment rate? Because in the developing countries, the economy is the people centric. The people is at the center of the, you know, the employment and let's say the economic growth. I thank you.
So, sorry, I'm not sure I understood the last part. Should we have technologies which use more people, which are more labor intensive rather than capital intensive?
Let me shed light on it, just like in this way that for the example of the Volkswagen, okay, in the Mexico, I'm mixed up with the blue and the white color because I landed in the middle of the supersonic, you know, presentation. In that case, you know, we had old model and the new model.
Yeah.
Okay, new model, you know, enjoyed, you know, the high quality. So, and then in place of, you know, the people, with the comparing the old model, okay, it is used, you know, as the picture, you know, depicted, they use robots.
Yeah.
So what happened to the employment rate, you know, when we use, you know, the modern technology? I thank you.
Roberta?
Just a question. I just wanted to ask you whether you could elaborate better on the sort of policy, further on the policy advice. One question is, when you show the graph of what happened in the market, you have firms exporting that are no longer exporting. Sort of, we usually think of liberalization as more firms entering in the market, including some of the small firms. So what is happening when there is quality upgrading? Is that the large firms who upgrade their quality displace also the small firms already exporting that? So in your chart at the very beginning, you have firms are in the market. It's only that those they are already exporting, and it's only that they reduce their exports. So while somehow in the back of my mind that when you liberalize, more firms that are close to the frontier enter in the market in any case. So in this term is sort of what your suggestion was to support quality upgrading in this context. Somehow, in a part, it's efficient, no, this mechanism. Why not then income distribution, or why?
Okay, I'm not sure. I think I got the answer. Okay, so good question. So
maybe a last, very last one, if there is one pressing.
Yeah. Thanks so much. I had a question about the size of enterprises versus ability to enter export markets. A lot of your data looked at this period kind of before the new millennium. And I'm wondering if you've seen any research or what your view is on whether those trends of larger enterprises being able to enter export markets more easily than smaller ones in the event of a devaluation or bilateral trade increasing, whether that still holds true today when perhaps, you know, I'm thinking of Alibaba, I'm thinking of more internet distribution, whether that's challenged some of the traditional models where perhaps the way you would enter an export market would be to do a very large volume deal with a distributor like Walmart. Thanks.
Even if you're small,
has the ability of smaller, more agile, I suppose, businesses to respond to trends like this improved now?
Yeah. Okay, good questions. So the first question about whether what's happening to the workers, are we displacing workers by upgrading technology? So this is a real issue. I mean, in the sense that often the high quality products are produced with technologies which are designed given the factor proportions in rich countries, right? So it's Germany and Austria are the center of the machine. These robots are built there, and then they're just imported into places like Mexico and then use the same factor proportions, even though potentially there might be many more workers to employ. So the question is there a negative aspect to that? I mean, in some sense, I can see that there would be, right, in the sense that there's fewer workers employed. On the other hand, my sense is also that the potential sort of knowledge spillovers generated from firms getting to the world frontier, technological frontier, is actually quite a bit more important than generating employment for a few more people in the short term. Okay, so I didn't really say that here, but I think this high quality production also is accompanied by learning, because you're producing products at the technological frontier for the world, and there's some learning involved in how to do that. And that actually can have very salutary effects over the long term, even if in the short term the factor proportions that are appropriate for using the state-of-the-art technologies are different from those that exist in many developing countries. That makes sense. So there's a trade-off there, but I think you actually are better off upgrading if you can. So it's certainly, I guess it's Roberta, yeah. So it's certainly the case that some firms that were exporting stop exporting, and some firms, you know, that always happens. You know, some firms become more productive, the owner becomes an alcoholic, whatever it is, there's negative shocks. And so you see transitions both directions always. But I don't think, or I would not attribute that to displacement of, you know, large firms entering the export market and displacing smaller firms, simply because the export markets are so enormous relative to the size of Mexico, right? So this, in the Mexican case, it's basically, we're talking about the U.S. market relative to the Mexican market, okay? And it's, the U.S. market is just many, many times larger than the Mexican market, okay? And Mexico is small relative to the U.S. market. And so it's just not clear that they're facing head-to-head competition at all. So I don't think it's rival in that sense, that like if one guy enters the export market and the other guys don't, and that's actually a reason, that's a distinction between the local market in many cases and the export market. It's a reason to support the export market, precisely because you don't get that sort of rivalry set up. So anyway, okay. And then, so it's a very robust fact that larger firms are more likely to export. That's every country, every data set that anyone's ever looked at that, it's been found to be true. And I'm not aware that that's become less true over time. Now, it's certainly the case that there are some small firms that are able to export, and it may be particular sectors that you know, that might be increasingly true. So software may be one of those sectors. But when we're thinking about what we can actually observe in data is typically not software, and also when we're thinking about the, you know, what are the sectors that are really important for developing countries, typically they're not going to be software, and they're going to be sectors that, you know, as I've found and lots of other people have found, really are, you know, the better firms are the big ones. That seems to be quite robust. Now, it didn't have to be that. I agree with you. Conceptually, it's not clear it has to be that way, but it turns out to be that way, that way in all the places that we're able to look at. Okay.
Thanks very much. Thank you very much again for this presentation, for your answers, for your ability to sort of convey this message to a public of non-economists. So thank you. Have a really nice break, all of you. And thanks again for attending this lecture. And see you next year.